You ever wonder why swamps and wetlands are important? How about lakes, rivers, and streams? How are they connected to the ocean? Where does all the rainwater go? Does it matter? The curious kids set out to find some answers, starting out at Lake Okeechobee.
What's the big deal with Lake O?
Lake Okeechobee is featured in our local news a lot. Some of us curious kids wanted to know why. Where better to begin our investigation than with a visit to the lake itself? Biologist Baron Moody with the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission offered to take us out by boat.
Where's the lake? There's so much vegetation over there.
The vegetation's growing on the levee and the lake is on the other side of the levee. This is the Herbert Hoover Dike that was built in 1930 following the devastating hurricanes of 26 and 28 when thousands of people drowned.
Thousands of people drowned? That's awful. What we began to learn on our trip is that in order to really understand the impact of Lake Okeechobee, you have to go back in time.
Geological surveys estimate that Lake Okeechobee was formed 6,000 years ago when seawater, covering much of Florida, receded. Sometimes called the heart of the central Everglades, the lake is like a portal that separates the watershed in the north from the southern Everglades and Florida Bay to the south. Before humans settled in Florida, rain that fell between Orlando and Lake Okeechobee drained slowly through the Kissimmee Basin into the lake. In years when there was lots of rain, the overflow would replenish the Everglades with fresh water. After the Herbert Hoover Dike was built to protect communities from storm surges created by hurricanes, the way in which the water flowed from the lake was forever changed.
All kinds of wildlife live in or depend on Lake Okeechobee, like alligators, birds, and of course, fish. Turns out, Lake O is a very popular fishing destination.
Do people come from all over the world to fish here?
Absolutely. Lake Okeechobee is a world-renowned bass fishery, and we benefit from the vigorous tourism industry of the state of Florida, and people come to the various resorts around the lake and enjoy fishing for crappie, bluegill, and largemouth bass.
FYI, the fish Mr. Barron mentioned were crappie, bluegill, largemouth bass, and that's me holding a snook that someone else caught. So how do you catch a fish like that? First, you need a lure, something that looks appealing enough for a fish to eat. Mr. Barron showed me how to attach a lure onto my fish hook. Then it was time to cast my line.
Now you hope that a big, hungry fish will come along and bite. You need a lot of patience.
What do I do if I catch a fish?
Well, first reel it in, but then we'll probably release it. The largemouth bass regulation on Lake Okeechobee right now is a 5-fish bag, and they all have to be 18 inches or longer. So unless your fish is 18 inches or longer, you're not allowed to keep it.
This is the only fish I caught.
How many species of fish live in this lake?
We've collected through our work 55 species of fish, and that even includes some saltwater fish like mullet and snook, because they'll move up the St. Lucie and Caloosahatchee River and come into the lake.
Do fish come and have their babies in the big lake?
Different species use different spawning strategies, but largemouth bass frequently spawn in shallow areas like the marshes.
Fish travel in and out of the lake through man-made locks that are controlled by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers.
Water released from Lake Okeechobee flows to the ocean in two directions.
West, through the Caloosahatchee River, and east, through the St. Lucie River.
Water diverted south to the Everglades flows through a conservation area.
This is where the water flows out of Lake Okeechobee.
And this is where the water flows into the Caloosahatchee.
Most of the news stories about Lake Okeechobee have to do with the amount of fresh water being released from the lake into the Caloosahatchee and St. Lucie rivers, and the effect those releases have on the estuaries and the ocean.
But why does that matter? Isn't it all just water? To find out, Jaden, Nicole, and Natalie went to meet educator Miss Susie Hassett and some of her students from Littleton Elementary School at Matt Lachey Pass Aquatic Preserve.
This aquatic preserve lies a few miles north of where the Caloosahatchee River flows into the ocean. It's between Pine Island and the mainland. It was a sunny day when we were there, and even though the water appeared to be clear, under the waves, it was a different story.
This is called a secchi disc. It helps us find out how clear the water is. The water needs to be clear enough for light to get down to the seagrass that grows on the bottom so it can do photosynthesis and produce food for all these creatures. It's the base of the food chain.
What we learned from testing the water for clarity and salinity is that balance is everything.
Salinity? What's that?
It's the amount of salt in the seawater.
The water can't be too murky or too salty either. It has to be just right. Seagrass might not sound very exciting, but turns out it's really important.
What is that?
Well, this is sargassum weed. A sargassum weed is a great home for animals. There are whole communities of animals that live in this floating seaweed. This is a brown algae, and you can find little shrimp and fish and crabs that live in the sargassum their whole lives. And baby sea turtles have to live in the sargassum for their whole first year of life.
Everything is interconnected. If we lose one thing, it could affect everything.
I like to eat oysters, but why are they good for the ocean?
Oysters are a great home for a lot of creatures that can hide in between, and they also filter the water and clean it.
The students find all kinds of animals in the water. Tiny crabs like this one. And then...
Oh, he is my favorite fish. He is beautiful. Look at him.
Does he bite?
He looks like he has wings. That's why he's called a sea robin. Here's a baby blue crab right there. He's gonna be a lot happier if he goes back into the oysters to hide.
Yeah.
Here's a little baby flounder.
Oh, the flounder?
Look, his eye migrates from this side over to the other.
Yeah,
surprised I'm not to catch them.
Yeah.
There are a lot of different things that can cause the water to be murky, and one of those is the extra nutrients.
Either fertilizer from a golf course, or a yard, or a farmer's field, or animal waste, those are all nutrients.
Does that go into Lake Okeechobee and then that comes here?
Yes, around Lake Okeechobee there are a lot of agricultural fields.
The extra nutrients can cause a lot of algae to bloom and cause the water to be murky as well.
Called decomposers, bacteria form the basis of an estuary food web. They break down the nutrients so that plants can absorb them more easily. When large amounts of fresh water carrying nutrients enter the estuary too rapidly, the bacteria cannot do their job.
What happens when the water level is too high?
If the water level is too high in the lake, there's a danger of the dike breaking and flooding the towns nearby, like Belglade. So they let a lot of water come down our river.
It's complicated. The communities that live around the lake have to be protected, as does the farmland that provides much of the food that we eat. But protecting the coastal waters is also important.
How many years have you been testing this water?
I've been coming to this spot for 25 years, and we've sampled the creatures in this water several times throughout those years, but we've been doing more tests just in the last 8 years because we come every year with a class, and so they're able to use some of these same tests, and it's citizen science.
A citizen scientist is someone who volunteers to collect data and share it with experts. Citizen science can really help scientists with their research.
We're going to look at some pH right now. pH is how acidic the water is. The water is more acidic. It's not good for the shelled creatures. So we're going to find out what the pH is by doing a little test. So what do you think?
The third one looks...
I think the second one is...
7.8 to 8 is the best range for seawater. We want to see seawater be a pH of around 8. So the pH isn't too far off. So that's good news.
Why is that good news?
If the pH is in the right range, that means all the shelled creatures are able to form their shells, and their shells will be strong enough to keep them alive. If the pH goes too low from ocean acidification, then it makes it really hard for those shelled creatures to survive. So our pH is okay right now.
Ocean acidification 101. Carbon dioxide is a gas. You can't see it, but it's released into the atmosphere both naturally and by human activities. The largest amount of carbon dioxide discharged by humans comes from burning of fossil fuels, like gas from your car. When there's too much carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it collects in the clouds and creates acid rain. When that rain falls on the ocean, it increases the acidity in the water.
Right now, we're looking at a trend for the oceans to change just a little bit, but even small changes can have a big impact on the sea life. It can affect the corals and it can affect the seashells.
If the water is too acidic, does that mean that there'll be no more shellfish?
Yes, even worse, there'll be no more coral reefs either.
No shrimp or crab?
Nope, sorry, they don't grow anymore.
Well, what about oysters?
They don't grow anymore either, they're all extinct.
I told you we should have gone for pizza.
So what do you think you could do about ocean acidification?
I'm not sure.
It's as simple as using your car a little bit less. If we have less exhaust from cars going into the atmosphere, there's less smoke to make.
Whoa, so much information. We started off learning about a lake, and now we're finding out that even driving a car can affect the ocean. The good news is that there are things we can do to try and make it better.
What's that?
It's a horseshoe crab.
And a can.
A can? Oy.
Pollution.
Yeah, that's no fun. If people would just clean up their own mess, we'd all be a lot happier.
I'm gonna take this can and recycle it.
Sounds like a good idea, but...
There's a crab.
Yeah.
Inside.
Oh, it's a good thing you checked. We wouldn't want to recycle him. Nature tries to make the best of any situation, but I think we'll leave the crab here and recycle.
Won't that cut other creatures?
Yeah, it might if we left it here. I think now you can recycle it.
The story of Lake Okeechobee shows us how humans have complicated things for the environment here. But as Miss Susie pointed out, nature tries to make the best of any situation. Let's work together to find the solutions that will keep Southwest Florida beautiful and thriving.
Hey, did you see the water at the beach the other day?
Yeah, it was brown. Yuck. I wish there was something I could do.
How about asking a local government representative?
How does that work?
Let's find out.
Heather Fitzenhagen is a Republican member of the Florida House of Representatives, which includes 120 members, each one elected from a single-member district. Ms. Fitzenhagen represents the 78th District, which includes the city of Fort Myers. I called her office to see if she would talk to me about the curious kids' concern for our water.
What can citizens, in particular kids like me, do to engage in protecting the environment?
There's a lot you can do, Jamie. You can get involved at school. You could organize a group of students that are interested in clean water, and they can speak with one voice. You can write letters. You can write a letter to Governor Scott. You can write a letter to me, and you can write an editorial for your newspaper at school or to the news press.
How can we prevent future water releases from harming the Gulf of Mexico?
We've got a comprehensive Everglades plan, restoration plan, that includes storing water, creating storage areas north end of the lake. We also can be thinking about ways to let the water flow south from Lake Okeechobee through the Everglades so that we'll be able to have more fresh water flowing into Florida Bay. It's very important, though, that I think we recognize that we need to try to have every stakeholder that's involved in keeping our water clean at the table when we try to fashion these solutions.
What's a stakeholder?
All the different people that affect the water. People like us, who use water for showers or in the garden, but also farmers and sugarcane growers, industry, hotels and businessmen, and fishermen. So what inspired Ms. Fitzenhagen to enter politics?
I think love of my community inspired me the most. I didn't take a traditional route to public service.
If you're concerned about our water quality, go to wgcucuriouskids.org to find out where to send letters.
Here's five simple things people can do to help protect the ocean. Drive cars less. Don't leave car engines running if the car is stationary. Don't use plastic bags. Take a cloth grocery bag. Recycle. Use environmentally friendly cleaning products at home and less fertilizer in the garden.
What do cute little frogs, wetlands, marshes, and sloughs have to do with clean water in Southwest Florida?
To find out, Andrew, Ava, and Sierra met Florida Gulf Coast University Professor Wynn Everham at CREW, which stands for Corkscrew Regional Ecosystem Watershed. They had lots of questions, like,
why is it important for water to flow slowly across the land?
When water goes fast, it's able to pick things up and carry it with it. Then it can carry dirt, it can carry things with it when it flows. So if you can slow the water down, then the things that are in it that we maybe don't want to send downstream settle out and aren't carried anymore.
Okay, but what kind of things are we talking about?
Plants need some things to grow. If you want to grow a lawn, you put fertilizer on it.
Wait a minute. Feeding the grass on the lawn is bad?
It's a little weird to think about. The stuff that we sometimes think about as pollution in the water is the stuff that we put on our grass to make it grow. But it's all about balance.
How do plants clean the water?
So as water flows through with those nutrients in it, the plants will pull the nutrients out of the water and put them into their own tissues. They'll take in nitrogen and phosphorus, but if you put too much nitrogen and phosphorus on them, it can make them sick. And so that's part of what the wetlands do, is try to bring that balance back to what's in the water. The real concerns we have in Southwest Florida is that as things come off the landscape, if it's not slowed down through wetlands, if the plants in the wetlands don't pull those out, then we end up with too much stuff in the estuary.
What happens when there's too much nitrogen and phosphorus in the water?
It can lead to harmful algal blooms, like the ones we've seen connected to the freshwater water releases coming from Lake Okeechobee.
That's not good.
No, it isn't. Not good for the environment, not good for the tourist industry either.
Have you seen a lot of changes in the waters over the years?
You know, South Florida changes a lot through time. And I think some of those changes have been good. You know, as you put more people in Southwest Florida, the population's grown a lot, then we end up changing the way that the water flows over the landscape. But people are understanding more than we used to understand how water connects us all. You know, that where we're standing right now, the quality of the water that's flowing behind us is influenced by the people who are upstream.
Do you live upstream or downstream?
I live upstream, so whatever I put in the water ends up downstream.
Like what?
Anything. Plastic, garbage, stuff you put on the lawn, it all flows downstream and ends up in the estuary.
I never thought about it. I will now, though.
So what kind of animals live out there?
Man, all kinds of stuff, Sierra. You know, what we're looking out on this marsh is good parts of the year, there's standing water out there. So everything that lives in water, in fresh water, you'll find out in that marsh. Lots of little fish, all kinds of different species that people would just call minnows. But if you look at them individually, some of them are really beautiful. And then bigger fish that will eat those, all kinds of insects that live down in the water, or insects that are feeding on the plants that are above the water, and then the things that are feeding on the insects, things that are feeding on the fish. So you'll see wading birds go back and forth through there.
Time to go and take a closer look at this wetland. Is it going to be muddy?
One leaf at a time. Oh, this is really interesting. If you guys look at this soil, I mean, look at how dark that is. So parts of the year when the water's really high, the water might be 10 centimeters deep here.
Does it ever dry out?
Yeah, it does. And so this, in 2 months, you know, before the rains will start, will probably be drier than it is right now. And then every once in a while, you'll get a really dry year, and this might get very dry. And that's the time when these wetland areas might burn. So a lot of the nutrients and the biomass that are tied up in these nutrients can get burned and shot back up into the atmosphere.
Biomass? What's that?
Vegetation. All the trees and plants. When they burn, they release carbon dioxide into the atmosphere.
So is that a good thing?
In a natural cycle, yes.
Like having enough wetlands to slow the flow of water across the land. Hey, did you know that frogs also help us check if the water is healthy or not?
One of the projects I do with some of my students is during the rainy season, we go out every month to different places in the county and we listen to what frogs are there. So frogs, because part of their life cycle is really, and some of them, all of their life cycle is really tied to water. If the water's not right, the frogs won't be there. So by going back over now 15 years to the same places and listening to what frogs are there, we can tell whether or not we've got the water right.
It was peaceful out there at Crew, and we got to hang out for a while after Professor Wynn left. Andrew found the snail, major food for the snail kite. He also found this fire ant nest. We steered clear of that. This wetland area is beautiful, and I'm glad it's protected in its natural state. The water downstream from here should be just fine, and that's a good thing for all of us.
Everything that goes into the ground seeps into the watershed and ultimately flows to the ocean. That includes any harmful toxins contained in household cleaning products. To protect the environment and her family, Jaden's mom makes her own cleaners using natural ingredients and essential oils. Let's see how she does it.
So we're making three different things. We're gonna make a scrub. What do you think you use a scrub for?
This scrub before?
Stains.
Yeah, stains like in the bathtub or in the sink or in the toilet. We're making a carpet powder to like make the carpet smell fresh and good. And we are making a spray to just clean surfaces and windows. So we're gonna make three things. Which ones do you wanna make first?
The spray.
Baking soda is the main ingredient in this scrub. It helps to get stains out. But what's this, soap?
Castile soap is made from vegetable oils, from coconut oils, from vegetable oil, from like kernel oils. It depends on what brand it is, but it's all natural and it degrades really well. So when you push it down the sink, it's not toxic, it doesn't clog things up, it just washes away, right? But it also cleans. We've got all different kinds of essential oils here. What are essential oils good for? Can anybody tell me? Do you know, Adam?
Peppermint is good for headaches.
It is good for headaches. So maybe if you're cleaning with a headache and you put peppermint in your cleaning stuff, your headache goes away and you get a clean bathroom. Right. So we've got lemon, we've got lavender, peppermint, we've got melaleuca, which is really good for cleaning like bacteria and nasty germs. It kills all of that stuff. It kills mold and viruses and all that gross stuff. So that's good for the bathroom, right?
Yeah. Lemon grows on a tree.
Peppermint,
a leafy plant.
Lavender, pretty flowers. Melaleuca, a tree.
Hey, isn't that an invasive tree here in Florida?
Yeah, it's native to Australia.
Essential oils are useful. They're derived from plants, okay? And what they are is that they're the compounds that live on the plant, and they're actually the plant's defense mechanism against germs, bacteria, disease, and pests. And so the essential oils in the plant protect the plant and keep it healthy. So we can use it to kill viruses and bacteria, not only in the house, but also within our bodies.
Essential oils smell good and give the cleaning products a fresh fragrance. So what about the cost of making your own basic cleaner?
Actually, it's a lot cheaper than the products in the store. I mean, you can buy a whole container of baking soda for just over $1. And you can make, a lot of cleaning product out of baking soda and a little bit of vinegar. So I would say maybe one batch of scrub that we made today would be about 50 cents maybe.
If this goes down the drain, will it hurt the environment?
Absolutely not. That's one other great benefit of making your own natural products.
Cleaning out the wickerts means not only using the typical household cleaners that contain phosphorus, nitrogen, and ammonia. These are the worst environmental hazards because they aren't removed through water treatment plants and they end up in our waterways. Check out the Curious Kids website for some simple ingredients you can use as natural cleaners.
Can you imagine having a mini wetland in your backyard?
Or in the schoolyard or at the mall?
Mr. Chad at the Naples Botanical Garden shows Sophie and Jaden how they use wetland plants to clean rainwater falling on their property.
Why are we in a parking lot?
Well, this is actually where the story of water begins at the garden.
The story of water?
Every drop of water that falls on this parking lot makes its way through a series of ecosystems that help to clean the water throughout the entire botanical gardens.
What's an ecosystem?
This group of native plants forms an ecosystem. And when water falls in the parking lot, it flows into this ecosystem, and these plants help to filter out the water. And they do that through taking up nutrients that might pollute our beaches and our coasts.
Next, it was time to learn about some flowering plants.
If we planted these flowers in our garden, would they help the water?
Not only would they help the water, but they bring in the butterflies and the bees. This yellow one is a coreopsis. One of the other names for it is tick seed. Why do you think it's called tick seed? What do you think the seeds look like?
Because it looks like a tick.
Exactly. The seeds of this are little curved shells, and they look like little bugs. This one's the blanket flower. This is the one that grows along our roadsides and along our beach areas.
Who'd have thought you could plant flowers and plants to clean water? Each section of the garden helps to clean the water a little bit more.
So this is our miniature Everglades. This is where all that storm water that fell in our parking lot flows through each of the different wetlands and comes up right at the head of this little river of grass. And during the winter months, there's not much water. Just like the Everglades, there's not as much water, so sometimes it can be drier. During the summer months, water flows through there and builds up and gets deeper and deeper. And in fact, this area is so much like the Everglades that we get wildlife that you would find in nature. So we get fish, frogs, birds. We've actually even had bobcats and their kittens that come. We know that it's functioning as an ecosystem, and it's helping to clean the water that falls in our parking lot before it goes into the Gulf of Mexico. Do you remember that drop of water from our parking lot?
Yeah.
Well, that drop of water has gone through each of these wetland systems as a giant rainwater garden. As it flows through that system, It gets cleaner and cleaner before it goes out into the Gulf of Mexico.
Before we left, Mr. Chad showed us something really cool.
What's a chain got to do with rain?
Well, this is part of our stormwater system. The rainwater that falls on the roof comes down this chain and goes into the stormwater system. It's a neat way of bringing the stormwater to light.
Maybe in the future, there'll be rain chains in gardens and native wetland plants in every shopping mall parking lot. That would definitely be something to drum about.
Good morning, my name's Billy. You guys ready to go for a bike ride today on the island?
Yeah!
First and most important, we gotta make sure you get your helmet.
Bike safety tip number one, wear a helmet.
Bike helmets are so important in preventing head injury that the U.S. government has created safety standards for them. Look for this sticker to be sure yours will protect you.
And a little secret, always put your finger under there. That way it doesn't pinch your chin when you're buckling it, okay? It should be nice and snug and should be down. There you go. You're all set.
Mr. Billy knows his stuff. He's been renting bikes on Sanibel Island for 30 years. He helped each of us choose the right size bike.
We need to make sure the bike is a proper fit for you, okay? So what we're gonna do, we can adjust our seat up or down here and get it for the right height. Everybody feel good on their bikes? Now we recommend that when you leave here, you always walk the bikes through the crosswalk. You always want to stop at a sign. Remember, whenever you're on a bike, you're treated the same as a vehicle, as a car. So if there's a stop sign, you should stop, okay?
And off we went. Time to check out the island and get some great exercise. Bike safety tip number two, share the road. This means keeping to your lane on the bike path. Ride on the right and pass on the left. Sometimes people ride really fast. Stay alert. Pedestrians also use the path. Be courteous and patient.
Bike safety tip number three, stop at all stop signs and use the crosswalk whenever possible.
There are 25 miles of shared use bike paths on Sanibel Island. Lots to explore, better get going. It's amazing what we got to see, like the exotic birds at Periwinkle Park Campground, ducklings, and what's this? A great blue heron's caught a snake. Guess that's dinner.
Bike safety tip number four, use your bell, horn, or your voice to let people know that you're passing them.
We got to see wildlife, like this anhinga. Wow, check out his sharp beak. And finally, we got to the beach. You never know what you'll see there or what you'll find. Biking's a great way to explore, and it's much better for our waterways than riding in cars or buses that emit pollution into the air. The pollution from vehicles falls back to the earth and is transported by runoff and groundwater into streams and rivers, and you know where they lead.
I love getting out and exploring Southwest Florida. Hope we helped you learn more about the importance of water. Go to the Curious Kids website at wgcucuriouskids.org to learn more.
Curious now, whoa, curious.